As journalists and television hosts, scripts are a lifeline. Each newscast, each story, it all revolves around a script.
But now it's time to go unscripted. That means we're not just going off script, we're throwing out the script altogether.
Each week, we're joined by fellow Farm Journal hosts and editors to peel back the layers on stories we've shared throughout the week.
Unscripted, it's real, it's raw, it's entertaining, and it's your chance to meet the personalities behind the personalities. I'm Tyne Morgan.
And I'm Clinton Griffiths. Welcome to Unscripted.
What a week.
I'm exhausted from the week. You know, every once in a while, in these news cycles that we get in, every once in a while, you hit just like this flurry of stuff, like big news that happens. And it is, it's kind of like this wave that we ride. And this has just been one of those weeks where there's just a million things going on.
Clinton, I mean, it goes back to the previous Trump administration. I mean, when they were in office, look at TV ratings, look at the news cycle. I mean, it was constant. And we're getting a taste for that now. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing, because it gives us plenty of things to talk about.
Of course.
Plenty of coverage. And just so many events happening, starting last weekend, unfortunately, heading into the RNC this week, and then a lot of other things. And so, Clinton, when you think about a week like this, it is exhausting. It's exhausting for everyone involved. And Clinton, you know, I know you're a man that gets things done. And so my question is, can you get the RNC to start earlier so that these talks don't begin at 9:30 Central, 10:30 Eastern? I mean, I feel sorry for you because you're on Eastern time. And so it's starting a little later.
Last night, or I guess it was Thursday night, whenever the president was giving his speech, it was midnight-ish by the time it got over. You know, it's just that. Of course, it was a long one. We'll get into that. Our guest is going to help us kind of break that down a little bit. But you know, the you work all day and then you go back and you just try to keep up with what's happening. And we'll have the same thing with the DNC whenever they have their convention, but. You know, you just try to keep up, and it's all day.
But talk about someone that's able to keep up. I don't know how he keeps up. Talking about a bird in the candle at both ends of the stick. I mean, he has been covering politics for decades, and so he definitely knows what he's doing. But his perspective and his insight this week, we knew who we had to have on. Who else would we have on this week other than the Jim Wiesemeyer? So let's welcome Jim to the program this weekend. Jim.
Hey, Jimmy Dubs. What's up?
How much sleep did you get last night?
I didn't get much. Let's put it this way. I think I got less speech than it took Trump to give his speech. Okay.
You got less sleep than what it took Trump to give his
probably,
speech.
Probably, yeah. It lasts 92 minutes it took. That's about half of a national baseball game. Yeah. We're into the fifth inning of a baseball game. That's perspective.
Yeah, it was quite the oration. And it covered a lot of ground. It was windy. It wandered. It was sharp at points, poignant at points. But there was a lot there, a lot to break down.
Yeah, too much. He needed an editor, as we well know at Farm Journal and elsewhere. You have pretty good editors there. But
does he not have one? I mean, doesn't he have someone that helps with these speeches?
Oh, they write them. But I think he dictates the totality. They're afraid to edit him, I guess. But it needed editing. Because look at what the RNC, this was the best run convention that most people have seen since Obama's first one. I mean, they scripted, they were pretty much on time throughout this whole convention. And I mean, maybe they had too many speakers, but they didn't go too much over their allotted time. But most people, I think, probably fell asleep at the end of at the end of Trump. I mean, just too long.
Jim, let's set up the week before we get all the way through Trump's speech. Let's set up going into it, because it kind of started over the weekend
at 6:11 p.m. Eastern time.
Yeah, absolutely. With the assassination attempt.
Yes.
talk about your perspective on that, because as a guy that's covered politics in Washington for a long time, these are kind of historic moments and milestones in our nation's history.
I'll never forget this one, like I didn't forget Reagan's, because those were the days where on Pro Farmer Newsletter, I would call in with a late story, and Mike Walston was the overseer of Pro Farmer at the time, and we kept on having to delay the printing of Pro Farmer, and he told me the week before, now, Jim, unless the president gets shot, we're not going to hold the presses. The very next week, believe it or not, the assassination attempt on Reagan occurred.
Unbelievable. When you saw this happen and this go down, what was your first thought?
I knew right away. I was at my computer doing a scheduling for the week ahead. And of course, I have my TV on all the time. And it was just vivid. You know, I guess I felt the same way as I felt when those planes went into the building in New York City. I knew instantly that it was not good. So I thought, oh my goodness. And then we didn't know the outcome until he got up, until the president got up with blood on his face, but then he held the fist. And you talk about drama. Now, in the past, that this changes people, and it did. I mean, you saw that in the early rounds, but from 6/11 on, the whole election changed. The dynamics, it could be the eventual end anytime soon, maybe by this end of this weekend, of Biden on the Democratic ticket. It changed the tone, at least initially, of what we heard from Trump yesterday. It was dynamic for sure.
Tyne, what'd you think? What was your reaction?
Well, I mean, Jim, I talked to Jim after it had happened. And you know, what's interesting is because this was at a rural Pennsylvania farm show site. I mean, you think about this. This is where they have their county fair, you know, where the 4-H and FFA kids show. And so there was a lot of rural folks in that audience. Kip Tom was there, Indiana farmer, who was in the Trump administration. Sid Miller was there, who is the current Secretary of Ag for Director of Ag for Texas. And then you also had a dairy farmer that I know, Clinton, you're going to talk about in a bit, because a dairy producer that you interviewed. But you just, I thought about it, you know, it's like where we live, rural Org, Missouri. If you had a rally there, I mean, how much excitement would be there? And everyone's coming in, and it's just in your backyard, and the pride that the president chose there, I mean, that the former president chose there to come and do his rally. And then for all of this to take place, I mean, it was emotional. I was actually taking a nap that afternoon. We had fair week. So I was preparing for fair week, and I took a quick nap, and I woke up, and my husband goes, Trump got shot. And I said, and I'm just standing there in disbelief. I said, did he survive? And he goes, yeah, I think he survived. And I mean, it's just your heart stops, because you just can't believe that it happened. I mean, the security that we have today, and we'll probably get into this in a second, there's a lot of question marks after last week and how all of this transpired. But I know, Clinton, when you talked to Larissa, what was interesting, because former President Trump mentioned this Thursday night in his speech, that he was looking at the crowd. Of course, he was reading teleprompter. He actually went off script to look at a graphic that was on the screen. And so he turned his head to look at that graphic that was on the screen and kind of leaned forward. And that's when the shots were fired. And that was so, and if he would not have turned his head at that moment and went off script and looked at that graphic on the screen, according to Larissa, it would have been a lot different. And so I thought that was interesting. You know, a lot of people, she said, got there at 8 a.m. It didn't start till 5. Wasn't supposed to start till 5.
He didn't come out until 6.
And he didn't come out until 6. And so you look at now the shooter, some of the video and the footage of him walking around. I mean, former president was supposed to come out at 5 p.m. And so it didn't come out until 6. But those people had been there all day. They said it was hot, but people, they were high in spirits. And then after it happened, after the shots rang out, after everything happened, the fact that everyone stayed so calm.
Yes.
Everyone that has been there mentioned that Trump mentioned that Thursday night in his speech, but just, it wasn't a stampede. People didn't run. People didn't, I mean, when the president, the former president got up, lifted up his fist, and everyone knew he was okay. It was like this, they said just this, the patriotism, the sense of just everyone coming together. That's kind of what stood out after the unfortunate incident that happened Sunday night.
All true.
Yeah, you know, I got to see President Bill Clinton speak when I was younger. And it's a president. It's a president coming to a rural area. This was New Mexico at the time. And anytime you have a former president or sitting president come to your area, there's a reason to be excited about it.
Oh, it's exciting. Because,
you know, this is the leader of our country. And so I think a lot of folks there were excited. Yeah, I think he's got some fans in Butler County, Pennsylvania. But I also think, you know, this is a rally. It's a presidential rally. We're going to go. It's going to be fun and exciting. We're just going to go see. We're just going to go look at it and see what happens. And then something like this happens. And, you know, Jim, I think, you know, for me, it's that disbelief that this happens. I wrote about it in my editor's notebook for the next issue of Farm Journal, because I want in 50 years when you pick that issue up to go, what happened during this time? And I want it to be in there.
Yeah.
And so, you know, for me, it gets back to this whole conversation about having a civil discourse and being able to discuss some of these big issues that face our nation without having to be angry about it.
Yes.
And people put so much weight on this one job, and there's a lot of jobs out there that are real important.
It changed Reagan, and it appears to initially have changed Trump. But
yeah,
as my headline today was, we heard two Trump speeches at the beginning, which was very unifying and very good. I mean, riveting. He said the only time that he will discuss in detail what happened in Pennsylvania was last night. And
it's too painful.
Too painful. But then the second half got into the more traditional Trump. So I think he lost an opportunity there myself.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
We do have a lot to get into. So let's go ahead and start off with our first segment. And really, we're not going to get into all of our segments today because this whole podcast is going to be talking tea. So let's get into our first segment today, talking tea. All right, Jim, we talked about Sunday's events and how that kind of set the tone. And you do believe that it did change Trump.
Absolutely.
You saw his granddaughter speak, who tried to show the personal side of Trump. Several of the speakers were trying to show the personal side, that this is that he is a real person. How many of those speeches do you think were changed from what they had planned prior to 6 p.m. Sunday and then what we actually saw?
Well, frankly, I think his son Eric's speech last night, that was pretty dark. I think that was probably Trump's original speech, and they just modified it. But definitely Trump, he said that. He said he just put away the 20 pages and started all over again. The other ones, I think the planners wanted to project at the beginning of this convention planning, an element of spreading the tent. And that's what you saw, because you can't change all those people that fast. And I think it was very well done, very well coordinated. The average person speaking, and there were a lot of dramatic, you know, moments throughout the 4 days of the convention. So, I think most people toned down any negatives that they had. Not all, but most. And it was very forward looking for the most part. Again, his son Eric got a little in the trenches. And then, of course, we had a split approach by the president himself last night.
Okay, let's get into his vice presidential pick, J.D. Vance, because for the average American, they didn't know who J.D. Vance was, had never heard him speak, did not know his backstory. Some had read his book, some had watched his movie. But for the average American, I think J.D. Vance was an unknown. So let's talk about the why. Jim, why is this Trump's pick for the ticket this year?
that's to continue the changes that Trump and his people want to see for the decades ahead. So this is kind of a mini me Trump, and that was a clear declaration. There were other reasons why he picked him. His sons, Donald and Eric, both urged him to pick J.D. Vance. And he's a populist, much like Trump, comes from Ohio, originally from Kentucky. And I do not think that it's a negative that he has not been in the Senate that long. In fact, I think it's a positive to many potential voters who are really leery of Washington anyway. So he'll bring a fresh perspective that way.
Jim, it seems like this was a choice to try to shore up that blue wall or try to take on the blue wall, right? To
absolutely
give Trump a chance at Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, Wisconsin, Minnesota, possibly. And I think it really feels like the former president believes if he can win that collection of states, he's got a real shot at it. And with JD, his kind of, and I want to call it more of a blue dog approach to manufacturing.
Yeah, that's what I was going
to
say.
Kind of an open hand to unions and bringing those jobs back versus the free trade, free market. You know, that the outsource and reshore type of approach to trade that we've seen in the past. It feels like that's really where JD comes to make that argument for the former president.
That's the expanding.
I don't expect him anywhere else in the country, though. I expect him in those four or five states the entire time.
They'll focus on that, and so will the Democrat, whoever the candidate is going to be. But the key thing on this election is enthusiasm gap. Right now, there's a big spread. The Republicans have it, the Democrats don't. Now, that could narrow depending on what happens to a potential nominee change. But as you said, Clinton, JD gives like a fifth gear on a car Trump's approach to those key swing states. And he could well expand the number of people who are going to vote, who probably would not have voted or would not have voted for Trump, because he brings in that, that sort of individual, younger, more labor people, manufacturing crowd, et cetera. I think he widens his appeal.
Jim, were you impressed by his speech? I mean, you know, listening to him, he's very easy to listen to. And his personal, you know, some of the personal stories that he told about his mama, which he calls the hillbilly version of grandma. That's what the hillbilly version of what you call your grandma. But
I had a mama. I also had a mama. I'm just going to say.
I mean, that's what I was going to say. We can all relate. I mean, he just us in rural America. I mean, we can relate. He was very relatable. He brought those personal aspects. You know, I've heard some critics say, "Oh, he wasn't that riveting. I don't think he's that charismatic." In some of those, but then I've heard other people say, listen, I could connect with him. He was very easy to listen to. He was very personable. What did you think about his speech one? And then also, was this a risky pick for Trump, or do you think this was a safe pick?
Oh, I don't think it was a safe pick. I'd probably be in the middle. I think it was a clear indication of Trump looking further ahead for his version of what Republicans should be. So he took the long haul. And as he told JD last night, he'll be 40 August the 2nd. So he's only 39 right now. But he looked to JD and said, "You're going to be in this industry a long time. Have fun." But as far as his speech, he's a writer. So of course he's got our heart right there. He's a communicator. You don't have to be a showboat to show people that you know what you're talking about. So yeah, he's not as dynamic as Vivek or Kid Rock or the Hulk, you know, but he he knows how to put words together. And I think he was effective. He stayed on message. And I thought his best angle, as you know, journalists do this, he had a bug of a storyline, and it was going through his growing up of President Biden, what he did throughout those decades. That was a little signal that you're pretty old, Mr. Biden.
Well, and not only that, it was a big signal. And in those signals, he mentioned things that directly will impact farmers. He mentioned
absolutely NAFTA, and his community.
That it was an awful trade deal, that it stole jobs out of his community. And that, and then he went on to talk about the drug addiction in his community, and he blamed China. He also blamed China on stealing American jobs. I mean, when he spoke, it was pretty clear that he is a protectionist. He is a nationalist. And Jim, I think you could say without a doubt, if Trump advances, if they win coming up in November, we will see increased tariffs.
No ifs, ands, or buts. Trump made that clear last night. And what in the front page of Pro Farmer this week, we have a line that both political parties have turned trade protectionist. And you know how many speeches I give in farm country. The ag sector is very nervous about that because we need an expanded trade policy. And both political parties are turning inward now rather than outward. And so there's a lot of high anxiety on this, but I don't see them changing. And if Trump is the next president, look to see if Bob Lighthizer, who was his U.S. trade rep in his first term, comes back in, which I think he will. And in what capacity? Because Bob Lighthizer and Trump and now J.D. Vance are in sync relative to the aggressive use of tariffs to invoke policy.
You know, I did hear a little bit of that from the president during his speech, talked a little bit about kind of the taxes and being able to reshore some of that money for corporate tax reasons, which was a big win for trying to get some of this work to come back to the U.S. to restart some of these manufacturing. I just think it's interesting. We had so much consternation about the tariffs, but they're still there. And nobody seems to talk too much about them. They never came off. The Biden administration continued them. And so, you know, Jim, I think it's interesting that we've talked a lot around about trade and how important it is for ag. And we know it is because, you know, we can't utilize everything that we produce here. And we also want to help feed other people. I think that's something farmers are proud of in this nation. But I'm not exactly
right now,
sure.
We're not talking trade, period. I mean, you look at this administration. I mean, I wonder if some of it is, we're just not even talking trade, period, to talk about how those tariffs are still on. I mean, I agree with you, but it's just, it's not a priority. It doesn't seem that way. It doesn't
seem like a priority.
Well, Trump will use tariffs as and his trade rep, if it's Lighthizer again, as a lever to get whatever they feel they need concessions from a host of countries. And that's really the reason why. So we're going to have to see. A number of countries may say, okay, what do you need for us to avoid tariffs? So that's a strategy that remains to play out.
Yeah, Jim, they're going to know this time that he'll use that lever because he did last time.
Is that why we saw China come in and buy some soybeans this week? I'm sorry, not China. Unknown. We all know unknown.
It could well be. It could well be.
Jim, before we switch over to talk about the big news item that could happen this weekend, what we're expecting. But before we do that, if we do see Trump Vance get elected in November, who do you think is in the front running for ag secretary?
I don't know, but it could be more of a populist tone that the mainstream ag sector won't be enamored with all that much. They won't say that publicly, but I mean, just think of Trump. He likes pretty characters. Mm-hmm. And so Sid Miller type, Kip Tom, to me appears to be too mainstream, but we'll see. He's on a lot of the panels right now. But it could be someone else. But I think it'll be more of the surprising side than
Jim,
most people.
What about like a Doug Burgum or a Kristi Noem, who maybe have some ag state ties?
I would love either one of those two.
Yeah.
Because why? Production agriculture.
Right.
they know production agriculture. And if it's a Burgum, boy, it would be good, not only from an ag perspective, but from an energy perspective. And I guess that's another big ag sector concern, both not only at the farmer level, but at the agribusiness level. Trump said from day one, he's going to do two things, close the border, and two, stop the electric vehicle mandates. He did not address other aspects of the Inflation Reduction Act that we really call the climate bill. And those were the biofuel tax incentives for the Z program and the 45B or whatever those numbers are. But that's the most frequent question I get from agribusiness and from farmers. Will those tax incentives continue? And I told them, until I hear it from potential President Trump, I won't believe anyone. Although the positive side is that some of his people tell me that he'll take the cue for that from farm state lawmakers, including Iowa senators Chuck Grassley and Joni Ernst. If that's the case, then he won't pell-mell get rid of those tax incentives that, as you well know, USDA Secretary Tom Vilsack says could well be the next revenue stream for agriculture.
Yeah, interesting.
Okay, should we switch over? Because the other big news, we've covered the unfortunate shooting last weekend. We've covered the RNC, but it sounds like we could see a change-up and a switch on the Democratic ticket. As of Friday morning, the talk is that President Biden is going to withdraw his name from the 2024 presidential election. Is he going to recommend that, or is he going to endorse Kamala Harris? There's a big question mark there. But Jim, okay, get us started. You said that Nancy Pelosi has been on the phones this week, so you had a feeling something is coming.
Yes. The pressure. I mean, she didn't dictate that he leave. She just said, you need to rethink this because it's starting to impact the down ballot. And that's what they're worried about. I mean, if Nancy Pelosi is good as anything, it's getting Democrats elected in the House. She has proven that. So I think it was starting to show up in their polls. And so that's why you saw her talking with Biden on that. The timeline for any getting out of the race is complicated because of his he has COVID right now. So I don't know. The rumor was that it could be Sunday, but you never get an award for guessing the right date. And now the Biden people in the White House are flat out saying the New York Times is wrong for suggesting this is going to occur. He's not going to pull out, et cetera. So believe who you want to believe. But the pressure is mounting. There's no doubt about it. If Biden continues to be defiant, then you're going to see more and more Democratic senators start to call for it. And that's when he'll cave. That's when
it sounds like we had former President Obama come out and make a pretty forceful suggestion, or at least a suggestion at all, which kind of raise some eyebrows here. Two questions for you, Jim. If they change candidates at this point, can everybody get on the ballots in the right states still? Or is it too late? Are we getting too close to those deadlines?
I think there's enough time.
Okay.
I think there's enough time. But they can't dawdle if Biden. Right. See, one of his things that most people were initially saying that Biden's trying to play out the clock, that the longer he goes, the more odds he has of being the Democratic nominee, which he wanted. But I think that's why some people are saying this weekend to get the ball moving. Whether the key unknown is whether or not Biden, if he exits, will pass the baton to his vice president, Kamala Harris, or whether or not he suggests a mini open convention.
What do you think will happen?
Who are the front runners then, Jim? Yeah. I mean, obviously the vice president would be probably front runner number one. And it's going to be hard for them to walk away from her, right?
Oh, very much so. Because you've got your Black Caucus. You've got that would get the party really having internal battles where Biden has been able to kind of keep them whole as well as he has. I don't think if they overtake her, that will lead to further enthusiasm problems on the part of their party. Gretchen Whitmer from the Michigan governor, Gavin Newsom, California, would be two possibilities. But honestly, I think they just said overnight that they don't want it. I have to reconfirm that. But, you know, if the party asks you, I think that they don't want to openly seek it. So it's probably just an element of that. Okay. But these polls are still close. And this is why Biden is probably looking at this and saying, look, there's only 3 to 4 to 5 percentage points difference. Why should I get out? You know,
Jim, but do we believe the polls?
You know, depends. I like state polls. So I would look the real clear politics. I believe that those are trend polls of a consolidation of different polls. So yeah, I guess I would believe looking at real clear politics.
I believe the bets in Vegas. Them. I'm just saying, I just believe the bets in Vegas. That's where you get your people putting money on this deal. That's
Money where your mouth is. Well, okay. What the Republicans are going to say is, look, no matter who is the candidate, the key issue is policy. The Democrats may change the person at the top, but will they change their policy? And this is what has a growing number of people upset at the Democratic Party. Their open border mentality, the how they dealt with or didn't deal with inflation, energy, food prices, the wonkiness, and things like that is really not changed when you think about it. And this is where the two parties are going to, you know, call the line. What policy do you want?
Okay, Jim. Go ahead. Let's say that then Biden decides to withdraw his name from the race. Okay, he does pass the baton to Kamala Harris. He does endorse her. Who do you think are the best options for a running mate? Probably has to be a male, right? You don't, I imagine they would pick a male.
Who's the guy from New York? I'm sorry, New Jersey. I can't think of his name right now.
I thought you were going to say Shapiro, but he's no. Pennsylvania.
Although Shapiro would be real. Okay, there's spot. That there would be a goodie. The governor, he has bipartisan support in that state. Mm. Somebody like that in a swing state would be a smart move on the part of any Kamala Harris at the top of the ticket. And Shapiro is an articulate person. If you've seen him on both CNN and Fox News, has had him on. Very articulate.
But Clinton and I were talking. It's not going to be a Gavin Newsom. Because that's from California. And you're not going to have a Gretchen Whitmer because that would be another female. And so just looking at the ticket. But that's part of the reason we still have Biden on the ticket right now, right? I mean, you look at who else could be a good presidential candidate, and that's been the problem in the Democratic Party.
Because they created their own problems because they didn't have a really open primary system. So that's what you get.
So as you look over kind of where we sit headed into this, the rest of the next couple of weeks here. I mean, Jim, we're like 2 weeks out to maybe trying to sort some of this out, but we could between last Saturday and the next 2 weeks, throw an Olympics in the middle of all of this, you know, we're on a cusp of like really changing a trajectory here for 2025 and beyond. Where do you put this in your history of turmoil and just kind of shifting sands under our feet?
It's similar to the 68 convention where Johnson pulled out. And that was not good for the Democrats. So I see it there that it's hard to come back if you have a different person ahead of your ticket that you thought almost all the way through was going to be your nominee. Not impossible, but a challenge. And then again, I will stress, look at the enthusiasm gap. And all you have to do is look at those five or so swing states in the Rust Belt areas. The Democrats can't lose one of them. And if Trump picks up even one, he'll very likely be the next president. But you know, Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report said that she complimented Trump on the first part, a compelling an account of his harrowing attempt on his life. But then this is her quote: Trump fell back to the rhetoric that he knows fires up his already committed base of voters. For Democrats, she said, this was a welcome reprieve from the steady stream of bad news that has defined the last 3 weeks of the campaign. It confirmed the theory of the case they've been making for months, that Trump's temperament, undisciplined style, and lack of a coherent future-forward message made him an inherently weak challenger. So that's going to be their credo for the months ahead, to go right after Trump, and he wasn't the unifier that he said he was going to be. They're going to try to pick a candidate, if Biden exits, that will galvanize all those many different factions in the Democratic Party, from the far left to the moderate Democrat, which is hard to do.
It's going to be a big task. I know when I was listening to the president's speech Thursday, you know, trying to prepare for our conversation here, it was interesting. I did think he started really well talking about what had happened. I thought, you know, he had a chance to kind of, you know, go through. And I think people found it interesting. I think they found it, to hear someone's personal story. And he said he was never going to talk about it again. I thought was an interesting point to make. And then it felt like he was back into campaign mode. And just on kind of, and I'm not going to say autopilot, because he would look up and then he would take off on the speech from time to time, but it just felt like autopilot a little bit, you know, kind of what he has been doing at these rallies for the last, you know, 8 years. And so I do feel like maybe he missed an opportunity to kind of throw the tent, you know, open and say, no, when I said unity, I mean this. And I didn't feel like he defined it well enough. It's probably in the speech, but at the 90 minute mark, I feel like it just kind of got lost in a lot of the other things that were said.
Right. Agree. Yeah. So this is an open election again, as far as the experts are telling me, you know. But Biden's funding is really being impacted here. That's the biggest thing, because campaign funding is the lifeblood of any campaign, and he's losing it right now. If anything's going to tilt him over, it'll be that.
But if we switch up candidates and we do see an announcement, that could re-energize their
campaign. Absolutely. Yes, and they're going to try to watch their campaign as well, because Democrats admitted the Republicans were in sync on this convention. It was laid out just on an excellent basis. I mean, timing, things like that. It had some oddities, but any conventions do.
Very diverse.
It moved along. Yeah,
diverse group of speakers. So speaking of that, okay, we're going to close out. With What the Sigma. All right. So our last segment, What the Sigma. Okay. So close out. I want everyone's What the Sigma moment of the RNC. There were so many high points, and you talked about that, and the unity and the messaging and just how in sync everyone was. You spoke about that. I mean, I heard someone say, listen, I haven't seen a national convention like this on either side of the parties since Barack Obama. So, it has been a while is what I heard some analysis on that. Okay. But what was your What the Sigma moment of the convention? Which, remember, Jim, in younger kids speak, that means what the hell. So what was your What the Hell moment of the convention?
The common people who had their sons or daughters killed. It was riveting. Not from a drug perspective, from a foreign policy perspective, from an illegal immigrant perspective, there was a connecting of the dots there. And what was the speaker who said she's fed up about being fed up? You know, I'm paraphrasing there, but that captured it as well. Just, and she used to be a Democrat, and so that spun. That's been the story, but also the movement of the hope that a number of speakers came with, that rather than being charged with hurting democracy, they're trying to get us back to democracy, what the court system and all that. That's kind of the overarching thing I got from the convention.
I thought, Tyne, I'll jump in here and then we'll let you take us home. I thought it was, and I don't know that it's a what the heck, but Jim, I agree with you. The cavalcade of folks that came across the stage that had been impacted in real life by some of the policy decisions, I thought was a powerful approach. It was a powerful message. You know, and as an American, how can your heart not go out for folks that have been dealt a tough card? So I thought that was impactful. I also thought the fact that, you know, we talked a lot about unity. The president campaigned hard. He always campaigns hard against people that are, you know, trying to win the nomination ahead of him. But he had, you know, basically the whole team there, right? I mean, Nikki Haley stopped by, Ron DeSantis stopped by, you know, Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz were all there. Like, you know, he had a host of support from every corner.
Yes.
Mostly every corner. You know, it didn't have Mitt Romney there, obviously, or former President Bush. But, you know, most of the people that have been challenging him over the last 10 years, 10 years, were there supporting him on stage. But obviously my What the Sigma moment was Hulk Hogan ripping his shirt off. I thought that was like my absolute...
it got the biggest applause last night.
The pinnacle of the entire event.
I mean, they knew how to get that crowd excited. I was hoping you would go with a funny moment because, Jim, I mean, you mentioned the touching moments, and I had so many tears. Like, I definitely cried during this. I mean, Clinton and I talked about it, the production quality of some of these videos, just how they were able to spark a lot of that emotion. It was emotional. But my What the Sigma moment for sure was Kid Rock performing and just the awkwardness of the crowd as you see everyone in suits and ties. And I mean, how do you dance to Kid Rock? There's not a good way. And they're trying to dance to Kid Rock. And so just to see that audience, and probably some of them that would never, some of them may see Kid Rock, but some of them would have never seen a Kid Rock perform.
See, live. It didn't look odd to me, Tyne. You know why? Because I went to enough 4-H and FFA dances growing up that's how people terribly dance to music. And so I just thought, hey, well, it looks like another 4-H dance or FFA dance here. people don't dance well.
That's what I got out of it is there are some terrible dancers in the
DNC party. Will probably beat the RNC in dancing, I'm guessing, and concerts.
I mean, just that moment as they're panning to the crowd, I'm thinking, quit with the crowd shots, okay? This is really awkward. Quit with the crowd shots. But it didn't matter. The crowd was excited. Like I mentioned, there were a lot of diverse speakers. Real quick, Jim, as we head into the Democratic National Convention, we will cover that. We will have a similar discussion talking about the DNC and what happens there. But do we know what that theme's going to be? I mean, it seems like it's in limbo right now. But there was a clear theme each night for the Republican National Convention. A lot of momentum coming out of that. How does the DNC top that?
I think they're probably revising after the Republican convention some of the strategies that they're going to do and to synchronize a little bit like the Republicans did. So I don't think it's laid in concrete yet. So I would watch for that. But the Democrats know how to put on a good show as well.
And they'll have some policy things to sink their teeth into with, you know, some of the statements and comments from the president's speech, from J.D. Vance's time in office, although it's been short. They'll have some things that they'll bring up, I'm sure, and work to galvanize over. It'll be interesting.
Wins to celebrate. I mean, you've got to look at the last past four years, celebrate some of those wins, and you know there will be some big names, some people from Hollywood that they pull in. I mean, you look at some of the big names that they were able to pull in for the RNC. We are definitely going to see that for the DNC as well.
I agree. By the way, Kid Rock was going to be in the Lake of the Ozarks, I think, this weekend.
Oh, time. There you go. Come on, get your boat out. Get over there and go watch Kid Rock.
Listen, we go to the lake. Those, I can't tell you how many seed hats I see at the Lake of the Ozarks. I mean, it's my people, Jim. It is my people.
But here's the bottom line for the Republican convention completed. Okay. The Democratic convention to come, look at the policies. Look at the policies, because that's what a voter eventually does. Some emotion, but still the policies. And we're going to see how the Democrats frame the issues as opposed to what we heard from the Republicans, and then let the best party win.
Jim, I hope you get some sleep this weekend. Thank
you.
I fear I may not. If we have a Sunday surprise, then it's back to work and nonstop.
But you're going to be at that concert at the Lake of the Ozarks. Other than that, you'll be good to go.
No,
I think he's going to open up a winery or something, is the word I heard. Okay.
Jim is going to travel to the Lake of the Ozarks coming up at beginning of August, right?
August 1, I'll be down there. Yeah,
there
get ready, Ozarks. Love it down there.
No way to get ready for you. Jim, thank you for joining us. Clinton, we'll wrap up. My husband and I and the girls attended a political event here locally. I mean, we have some big races in Missouri this year. We attended a big political event at a farm just down the road from us. And, you know, an election year, there's a lot of ads out there that will try to villainize the opponent. There's a lot of ads out there where it can bring out the worst in some people. But I'm telling you, at those political events, just to see everyone come together with the common goal and really who have that America First approach, and just to talk to everyone in the room, it's refreshing. An election year can be exhausting, but when you go to a family farm like that and you see everyone in the same room that are working toward the same goal, it's a reminder that there is so much good left in rural America. And so I think, you know, that was my takeaway this week. As you look at the RNC going on and you look at everything that's happening coming up and anticipating the DNC, but you look at the local level, what's happening heading into these primaries, that in quite a few cases, there are going to be some major races happening. It's just good to get together with some like-minded people that have the common goal of, America First. And so, that was a positive this week, along with our county fair, but that was definitely a positive this week.
Well, I think anytime you can just, I've heard a guy say whenever he's on and talking, he goes, people need to just get outside and touch grass. And I think that's really true in our society. It's real easy to sit at your computer and your echo chamber and scream at the screen and get angry and get mad. But every once in a while, you need to go outside and just look people in the face. And I think if I take anything away from the last week or so, it's just a reminder. And it was hard, you know, through the COVID, you know, years or a couple of years and everything like that. I think we lost touch of that. And I just think it's a really good reminder to get outside and talk to people face to face. We have so much more in common than we have, different. And we don't have to agree on everything. That's okay. Nothing, your whole life doesn't have to be the same. In fact, it would be really boring if it was. I have that same top, but I didn't wear it today, Tyne. You know what I'm saying? It would be really boring if we wore the same clothes every day.
Yeah,
but, I just feel like, we need to be able to get outside and remember that we're all people, we're all Americans, we're all here fighting for our families and for our futures and for our own lives, but we can do it together, and we can do it without being angry with each other. That's okay. And maybe we take a breath, we go outside, and we touch some grass once in a while.
Well, and it was the same way at the county fair. I mean, you look, we're a really small community, and the number of people that came out to support the kids. My husband has one rule, and that's the girls can't show living animals; they have to be dead. So we show cured hands.
Yeah, how they do.
We did really well. The girls are awesome. Are thrilled. Awesome. They're a little frustrated with me because we're going to go make them sit down with an investor and figure out how to invest the money. And apparently my 8-year-old's already decided she's all in on Tesla because she loves the truck, the Cybertruck. And I told her, well, maybe we need to diversify a little bit. But anyway, you know, just to see everybody come out and support those youth, there's a lot of dollars that flows at the county fair, whether that be with the livestock sale, the ham sale, whatever that be. But the amount of support and you know, it's some trying times in ag right now. And there's some struggles. But to see everybody come out and support those youth, that was just another reminder. We live in the greatest country. And to be in rural America, it is the greatest place to be. And so that was another friendly reminder, refreshing reminder this week. So a lot of good out of this week. Probably a lot of news still to come that we'll have to digest through. You're off for a couple weeks.
I'm off for a little while. Speaking of kids, taking my son on a farm tour with his FFA class to Ireland. So I'll be gone through the rest of the month. And you know, it's should be a lot of fun. I'm not sure what all we'll learn, what all we'll see, but I'm looking forward to doing that and spending some time. There's a bus of about 50 kids going, and I'm a chaperone. So pray for me, wish me luck, and hopefully we make it there and back in one piece.
I'm just so glad you said yes. Because when I heard of the opportunity, I was so afraid because you are so busy with everything. I was afraid that you would just everything that needed to be done with work and everything at home that you wouldn't go. This is going to be an amazing opportunity for you.
Oh yeah, it'll be great. And it's a country I've never been to. You know, looking forward to it. Can't wait.
Take lots of photos. We can't wait to hear about it.
All right.
I'm probably going to have Davis and Chip on without you since they celebrated. You guys have a party.
Yeah, we're going to have a big party.
I got it. I'll probably send them cake and ice cream in advance. So anyway.
You would.
All right. That does it for Unscripted. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. Have a great one, everyone.
Thanks for joining us. You can dive into more of Unscripted on Farm Journal's YouTube channel and listen to it anywhere podcasts are found. I'm Clinton Griffiths.
And I'm Tyne Morgan. From all of us here at Farm Journal, keep it real as you live your life unscripted.
Unscripted is a production of Farm Journal Studios, where no one grows alone.